A lot of games will have something known as a game controller. The exact purpose of it varies from game to game, but generally it's for handling information that needs to be widely available or for controlling objects in the game that have a dependency on one another. One example might be using a game controller to calculate a score based on how many items were picked up. Our game controller will be handling a variety of tasks, but most importantly, it will be storing the last known location of the player. To make our game controller, we'll start by creating an empty game object. Go to Game Object, Create Empty. We'll call it Game Controller and tag it with the Game Controller tag too. We're going to use the game controller to play the in-game music, so give it an audio source component and then drag on the music, which you'll find in the audio folder. Assign the clip music_normal to the audio clip setting. We want the music to play as we start the game, and we want it to loop, so make sure that play on awake and loop are checked. We also want to reduce the volume of the music slightly, so set the volume to 0.8. The audio source has a tooltip to tell you whether a clip is 2D or 3D. We want this clip to be a 2D sound so that the volume does not change with the position of the audio listener. In addition to playing the main music, we're going to have more panicked music playing when the alarms are going off. Rather than simply switching the audio clip that is playing and creating a gap, we're going to have an additional audio source on a separate child game object that can fade up the panic music as we fade the main music on this object down. Create another empty game object by going to Game Object Create Empty and name it Secondary Music. Make this a child of the game controller by dragging and dropping it onto it in the hierarchy. The only component that this child game object needs is an audio source. Go to Add Component and choose Audio, Audio Source. From the audio folder, assign the clip music_panic to the audio clip setting. This should also be a 2D sound. This has been set up in the importer settings for you. We also want this sound clip to loop. We also want to make sure that we can't hear the music playing at the start of the level, so we'll set the volume to 0. Instead of unchecking play on awake. We're going to have two scripts on our game controller, but right now we're just going to add the first. The script will be handling where the player was last sighted and what operations to perform when the player has been sighted. Other scripts will be referencing it in order to know the last sighting of the player, so we will call it Last Player Sighting. Click on the game controller, and at the bottom of the inspector, click Add Component. Choose New Script and name it Last Player Sighting. Double-click the icon to open it for editing. As usual, we'll start by removing the default functions in the script. We will start with the public variables. The most important variable in this class will be the position of the player when he was last sighted. Naturally, this needs to be a vector 3 and we will call it position. We're going to set a default for this of 1000, 1000, 1000. This is going to represent the enemies not knowing where the player is. Whenever this is the case, we'll set the position back to this value. The value itself is arbitrary, but it's important that it's not a position that the player could theoretically get to. When the enemies see the position as 1000, 1000, 1000, they will ignore it and return to patrolling. Now we're going to store this reset position as a separate variable so that we can set the position back to it whenever we need to. In this script, we also want it to control the light fading, alarm, and sirens. To do these things, we'll need a few more variables. Firstly, in order to fade the main directional light, we'll need a couple of float variables for the intensities. We'll also need a float for the fade speed. The last public variable we need is a speed that the music will fade in and out at. We've set some defaults for these values, but they are public, so we can tweak them in the inspector later if we want to. We don't need any more public variables, but we do still require some private ones. We need a reference to the alarm light script that is on the directional alarm light that we set up earlier. This way, we can switch on the script's alarm on bool. We'll call this reference alarm. When the alarm turns on, we're also going to need to fade out the main light. We don't have a script to do that, so we'll do it here. We just need a reference to the light itself. We need two more references. Firstly, to the audio source on the child game object, which will play our panic music. We also need references to the audio sources of the sirens. To store them, we'll use an array. Note that the array is denoted by the square brackets after the data type. Now we're going to use the awake function to set up our references. Add this now. First, we'll get a reference to the alarm light script on our alarm light. We'll do this using a find game object with tag function, passing in the alarm tag from the tag script that we wrote in an earlier assignment. From this reference, we can use the getComponent function to find the alarm light script. Next, we can find a reference to the main light. Again, we'll use the find game object with tag function and pass in our main light tag. But since Unity has a shortcut for the light component, we won't need to use getComponent at the end here. Next, we can get the reference to the audio source that will play the panic music. Rather than use gameObject.find or try to find it via a tag, we're going to use transform.find. This will search through all of the children of a transform to find one of a given name. Since the secondary music audio source is a child of the game controller, the function will find it. From this reference, we can use the shortcut to the audio component. Without diving into more advanced scripting, we can't directly get an array of siren audio sources, but what we can do is get an array of the game objects they are on, and then for each of those, find the audio source component and allocate it to our array. Let's start out by making the array of siren game objects. We're going to use the function findGameObjectsWithTag to return the array we want to deal with. We can pass in tags.siren to get the game objects that we want. Now we have the array of game objects, we can set the length of the siren's array. This is important because we need to set the length of an array before we can allocate to it. The length of the array is defined by what is inside the square brackets. Now we have two arrays of the same length. Next, we need to loop through the siren game objects array, and for each element, assign an audio source reference to our array of sirens. So effectively, we are finding a set of tagged game objects that we know have audio sources, placing them into a game object array, and then looping through that array and assigning the audio sources on each of those objects to an array of audio sources. Now we need a function to toggle the alarm light, main light, and sirens on and off. Remember that the condition for the alarm to be on is that the player has been spotted. This would mean that the position variable is not the same as the reset position variable. In this function, we first need to set the alarm's alarmOn variable to be equal to this condition. This part will return true or false, depending on whether the vector3s are different or not. Next, we need to fade the main light's intensity between itself and the new intensity. But before we can, we need to decide what the new intensity is. First, we'll create a float to store the new intensity. Now, if the position is not equal to the reset position, and therefore the alarm is going off, we want the new intensity of the light to be low. Otherwise, denoted here by the else, we want the new intensity to be high. We can now lerp the main light's intensity between itself and this new intensity. We will use time.deltaTime and fade speed as the time parameter of the lerp function. Next, we need to tell the sirens whether or not to play. We'll do this by looping through the array. If the position is not the reset position, and the siren audio source in the array is not already playing something, then it should be playing. Now we'll add an else to this, which says that if the position is the reset position, then the siren should stop playing. And that's the end of the switch alarms function. Now that we've completed this, we can call it in our update function. We're going to put the update function above switch alarms, but the order of functions in a script do not affect how they work. We're simply doing it to make it easier to read. The last thing we need to do in this script is to handle the music fading in and out. We'll do this in another function. After the end of the switch alarms function, add a music fading function. First, we need to check if the alarm should be going off, that is, that the position is not the reset position. Then, if this is the case, we want to reduce the audio volume. We do this using mathf.lerp. We also want to increase the volume of the panic music, so we simply do the reverse for the panic audio variable. We're setting a maximum volume for the music of 0.8, as we did in the inspector earlier. Conversely, if the position is the reset position, we want to do the opposite, fading in the normal music and fade out the panic music. That's the end of our if-else structure. Now we simply need to put a call to this function in the update. That concludes the work on this script. With it finished, we can now test how the alarm looks when it's set off. We can do this by playing the scene and setting the position variable to something other than its reset position. Save the script now and return to the editor. Press the play button at the top of Unity. And in the game controller, set the position value to something other than 1000. In other words, simply adjust one of the three values in the Vector3 variable, like this. Now you can see our alarm goes off and our panic music begins to play. This means that our game controller is working properly. Stop playing the game now. Now that we've finished work on our game controller, drag it into the prefabs folder in the project to save it there as a prefab. This concludes this assignment on game controllers. In the next assignment, we'll work on our CCTV cameras, which will detect the player as they walk around the level.